Good evening. I'm Darren Walker. I have the great honor of serving as president of the Ford Foundation and welcoming you to this special occasion. I want to thank you all for being with us this evening. And before I proceed with thanks and gratitude, I have to call out a special colleague, a remarkable woman, indefatigable intelligence and brilliance, whose vision it has been for us to gather on the occasion of the Kerner Commission's 50th anniversary. Please welcome and offer gratitude to my colleague, the irrepressible, inimitable Farai Chidea. So happy that Farai is at the Ford Foundation. And as we gather on this occasion to reflect on media and journalism and democracy, we are gathering at a moment when the press in this country and around the world finds itself under assault. From a more divisive discourse to the emergence of echo chambers on the air and online, to the threats of freedom of the press, to questions about truth and basic facts. We are facing an information crisis in this country. And according to a recent poll commissioned by the Ford Foundation, 3/4 of the people surveyed, regardless of their political views, believe that fake news is a serious problem in this country. But we are not powerless. It is worth pausing to remember that a free and independent media is an essential component of any functioning democracy. And the media cannot serve our representative democracy if it isn't representative of our democracy. So when we talk about diversity in the media, what is at stake is not just diversity. What is at stake is our democracy. And one of the greatest threats to journalism, and by extension, our democracy, is not merely the misrepresentation of facts. It's the lack of adequate representation of people in the stories that are told, in who tells these stories, and in the leadership, yes, the leadership of our nation's news organizations. In fact, inadequate representation and misrepresentation are deeply related. But this is not a new insight. 50 years ago, the Kerner Report shined a light on this very phenomenon, especially as it related to the media's coverage of the painful events here in Detroit and in Newark in 1967. And their concern about diversity in newsrooms was not an end to itself. It was necessary to help the rest of America understand the problems faced by the African American community, and through understanding, bridge the divides in our society. Today, it is not just a matter of racial inequality in the media. There are also other communities who are not covered equally or effectively, who are not adequately represented in the media. For example, it's easy for me to imagine how a rural American feels left out by newspapers and television stations based in the major cities and on the coasts. It's easy to see how people without a college degree might feel they are not the intended audience of some journalism and begin to question the value of journalism. And it's easy to understand how people might be frustrated by the media when it does not reflect their lived reality. At Ford, we see this broader lack of representation in coverage and in leadership as yet another manifestation of the inequality we are dedicated to fighting against in this country and around the world. And so the question for us is, how do we close this gap between where communities see the media, where they don't see their daily lives reflected? And at the foundation, we believe that the opposite of inequality is justice. And some 50 years ago, the Ford Foundation and others saw the recommendations in the Kerner Report and took action in addressing the imbalance and inequality in the media. At that time, the foundation helped establish public media. We invested millions in several programs to train journalism of color. That helped to ignite the careers of hundreds of reporters and editors. And we provided seed support to new affinity groups. These were important steps, but they were not enough. We still have much more work to do. And while there is agreement about the problems we face, I am hopeful that there can be agreement about the solutions we need. In fact, our polls show that a majority of Americans, including 50% of white Americans, believe that hiring more racial minorities in the media will improve the quality of news in this country. And that's part of why we are here on this special occasion, to reflect on and commemorate the Kerner Report, and to recommit ourselves to a free press that represents all of us and reconnects our divided democracy. We must bring the lessons of Kerner into the 21st century. We must build a media that holds up the mirror to our society and that allows all of us to see ourselves reflected in that mirror. Together, we can strengthen the perspectives of our news media and the foundation for our democracy. I believe we can build a better America by building a better media that reflects and respects the whole of America. Tonight, we'll hear from some of my heroes and sheroes, journalists, artists, media luminaries, who will share their insights and their wisdom on the subjects of media, journalism, diversity, and democracy. To kick off tonight's discussion, please join me in welcoming Richard Prince to the stage.
Well, good evening, everyone, and amen to that. I started actually my own career not in 1967 in Detroit, but in 1967 in Newark. We know about how all this started, and of course, next year was the release of the Kerner Commission Report, which we're discussing tonight, and we're here to find out and to discuss what's happened in those 50 years, how much progress have we really made. And we've got some fantastic panelists here. Marie Nelson, Vice President of News for PBS, Jelani Cobb of The New Yorker and Columbia University, and Bill Plante of CBS, formerly CBS News. And I want to hear first from Bill, because we want to provide some context to the times in which all this took place. And Bill was down there at Selma with Dr. King and others. And I'm really eager to hear what he has to say about how those times, what the lessons of those times are for the times that we live in now. So come on up, Bill.
Thank you, Richard.
Yeah.
You want me to come up there?
Please do.
All right.
No? You don't want to? Okay. Never mind. Never mind. I should. Okay. All right. Never mind. Go ahead, Bill. That's what we have to use.
That's right.
During the Civil Rights Movement, I spent a lot of time in the South. I was a brand new reporter for CBS News. I grew up in Chicago, had never been much south of St. Louis, and going to Mississippi and Alabama was like going to the moon. but I soon saw what was going on. And what we covered there was basically about people's right to vote. Now that was something that the average American could get their head around, because they all believed, or most of them anyway, that the right to vote is an essential human right, an American right, guaranteed by the Constitution. So when the violence happened at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge on that day in March 1965, Americans were horrified. And that helped Johnson get the legislation passed, which he did that August. And I think we make a mistake if we conflate that with the problem we're talking about here today. Because while people would generally agree that the right to vote was important, they didn't understand what we saw in the unrest of the 67, 68. I covered many of those things. I wasn't here in Detroit, but Cleveland, Chicago, a number of other places. And it went way beyond the people who were throwing the bricks through the store windows. You could understand by talking to people and being around for a while that they were, if not throwing bricks, still upset because of the way they had to live. And we didn't have any conception of that as a bunch of white reporters. It only gradually began to dawn on us. And it finally dawned on people after the unrest in 67, 68, that it might be a good idea to have some people of color as well who would understand at a gut level what was going on. So there were programs started. There was some very small bit of progress made. And over the years, there's been more, but not nearly enough. And I'll leave it there for now.
Okay. Well, Marie, you've been looking at, we were just talking, and she was saying that she was looking at some of the headlines, some of the newspapers of the time. What takeaway did you have from looking at that?
Well, I am proud to say that I wasn't alive in 1967.
Okay.
I'm holding on to that. But I did. I wanted to go back, and I wanted to read the headlines, and I wanted to see what the reporting was like at the time in here in Detroit. And it's stunning when you look at the Detroit Free Press, and you read headlines that sound as though, you know, there's a war going on against, you know, some sort of foreign entity. And you could very clearly see the distance between communities as reflected in how the story was covered. But the one cover that really stood out for me was a Time magazine cover where they had done some illustrations. And in the center of the illustration, you had a burning storefront, and then surrounding it were images of a white law enforcement officer, weapon at the ready, white firefighters combating the blaze, you know, panicked, you know, fearful white citizenry, white politicians, and literally nowhere in this frame was there a single person on the other side, not just, you know, as a, you know, perhaps a looter or someone who is responsible for the violence, but someone who, in fact, played one of these roles in this community and in this society. And so to me, it's like you look at that and then you fast forward. And while there are so many ways in which we need to improve the situation, but when I fast forward and I look at America where I have a Jelani Cobb who we have out there riding shoulder to shoulder with the Newark police doing a frontline piece on policing the police, or you have, you know, the great late Gwynne Ifill who's out there, who travels to Ferguson in the aftermath of what was happening there. And the first thing that Gwen did before we shot a frame of video for this town hall meeting is that she wanted to go directly into that community and to spend time where Michael Brown was killed and to spend time talking to the people who are in his neighborhood. So when I see that level of transformation, I know that we are on the right track.
Okay. Now, Jelani has been, you mentioned Ferguson, you mentioned Newark, you've been in these places. You weren't around 50 years ago, but you, I know that there were some.
Disconcertingly close to 50 years ago. 48 well, years and 6 months or something like that.
Oh my goodness. Okay. Well, in any case, what similarities do you see and what changes have taken place that you can tell from the perception of people in these communities toward the media?
Can I just take 1 second, though, mm-hmm. and echo Marie's point? Like, when you said that about Gwen, I felt like this pang. I think that probably a lot of us felt that because she just exemplified so much of what we aspire to. And her, yeah.
Yeah, she was here.
Her absence is still, like, sharp in that way. So there are a couple things in terms of the patterns here. Like one thing is that looking at the report, it exists in a very particular context. And you know, of course, the history of the United States, you know, the American Revolution comes out of essentially a bunch of riots, you know, against the British. And you know, this country's history is dotted by riots, bread riots, labor riots, you know, all sorts of draft riots, and so there is a chronology of this, but when there are these riots relating to African Americans, it seems so inscrutable that they have to commission reports to understand what's going on. And the thing that's interesting is that, you know, 1935 in Harlem, there is a Puerto Rican teenager who is beaten by police, and it results in a riot. They issue a report. They have commission issue a report. The report comes out and says, well, you know, the conditions of black people in Harlem largely factor into why we had this riot in Harlem in 1935. And then you can kind of go through. There's a riot in Detroit in 1943. You all get a commission out of that and a report. In 1967, there's a report on Newark. And that report, which I've actually seen, we were working on the Frontline Project, is like 7 or 8 volumes and 1,500 pages, maybe, or longer than that. I mean, they're these huge books, but they come down to the conditions of black people in Newark. They've been excluded from opportunity, and it culminated in this riot in 1967. And Kerner is part of that constellation, and it's the most comprehensive because it's national. I'm sorry, Baltimore, I left them out. They have a report, too. Which I looked up after Freddie Gray. Mm-hmm. And so it's almost like a kind of second coming, because as these things have been happening, you know, the Newark police were under you know, this consent decree, so I looked up their report from 67. Freddie Gray happened in Baltimore, so I looked up their report from 1968. We're now on the 50th anniversary of Kerner, and there's a whole kind of national conversation that we need to have. And the fact is that it goes back to that fundamental question of the American will to break its addiction to racism and white supremacy.
Okay, we got some support there. All right. Well, Bill, let me ask you this: you saw the mood of in your reporting in the '60s of African American communities, and you've heard about and seen reports and maybe firsthand knowledge of the mood now. And the, do you see similarities, or is there cause for a great hope?
Richard, when the Kerner Commission report came out, mm-hmm. I remember that we were, I was certainly, stunned by the idea that they had said right there on the page, two societies, headed toward two societies separate and unequal, and then went on to talk about all of the problems that the black community had, then also went on to criticize the media, which was deserved. Mm-hmm. But I see some improvement, mm-hmm. but I don't see that much has changed.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And how about in our newsrooms? Maybe Marie and Jelani will can talk with that. Has there been much improvement, or are we still saying there's so much more to do?
I mean, I'm incredibly proud, certainly, of the journalists of color who have come into the industry, and so we acknowledge that. But fundamentally, newsrooms are largely unchanged. I am proud to serve at PBS. I am the most senior African American writ large, but African-American woman in this instance, in public television news. And if you were to say to me, who comes after you, I could certainly identify a pipeline, but I would not say that these are people who are already in the system. They're people I would have to bring into the system.
Mm-hmm.
And so whether it's developing a pipeline, really working to create opportunities to bring people in earlier in their career so that they do have a chance to rise up and stay within these institutions, and not just having, a values level conversation around diversity in our organizations and advancing that to the level where people are committing the resources and working this as we do any other aspect of our business plan. That's not happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there's, there was a phenomenon we saw a decade ago, which was that right around the election, I think that some newsrooms looked up and realized that there were more black people living in the White House than working for their publication. And in many instances, it was literally true.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, wait, we have to get some of those, that kind of thinking. literally someone said that to me, we have to get some of those. And I was like, you should go out and get some. But toward the end of the Obama era, in some of the kind of more visible places, MSNBC, I think, was egregious in it. You saw what people on Twitter were calling the unblackening, where, Melissa Harris Perry was gone, then Toure was gone. I'm leaving somebody else. Then they absurdly got rid of Tamron Hall and replaced her with somebody that nobody likes. And so it was like, there is that kind of fluctuation. And so it's not the idea of whether there's been change, sure, but has there been permanent change? I think we probably see an EKG kind of effect, where it goes up and drops, goes up and drops, goes up and drops, and then if we average it all out, it wouldn't look that much different over time.
Yeah, but that brings into question the motive behind the change.
Mm-hmm.
Is it simply to have more people of color because they know that they should?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it to bring people in who understand other cultures?
Right. And can I say really quickly, mm-hmm. I think that I always talk about David Carr, who brought me into the Washington City Paper. And Carr did, he came to the Washington City Paper. There were very few black people there. It was in D.C. He said, we have to diversify. In his first kind of swing, he got me and Ta-Nehisi Coates. Mm-hmm. We were the first people that he brought on. And he was like, not even really trying. And so Carr did what he did, and I respected him for this for his entire life, out of the best reason to diversify. He felt like there were stories he was missing. And as an editor, he was like, I want those stories.
Yes, here, here. Well, that's what I wanted to, I'm glad you brought that up. One of the things about the Kerner Commission report is that they did talk about the fact the media was shockingly backward in hiring, training, promoting Negroes, as we were called at the time. But they also said that the media, one of the biggest problems is that the media were presenting the world through white eyes. And I wonder if you could talk about that a little bit. I mean, we know it's not enough just to have some diverse bodies in the newsroom or in the executive suites, but what do we do about changing the perspectives that are offered in the news media so that when people of color pick up the newspaper or watch the newscast, they say, yeah, they got it right. They're not just giving me, somebody else's view of the world.
I mean, what you're talking about is, I like to think of as authenticity,
yes.
Right? But in order for you to have authenticity in the newsroom, you also have to have power.
Yes.
Mm. And so, we were having an interesting exchange earlier today about some of the writing that's been done around the Kerner Commission anniversary.
Oh, yes.
And perhaps, an opinion desk where they thought that it was okay to suggest that this was, a relatively unknown commission
mm-hmm.
Based on, the limited perspective of those who happened to be around that particular
right.
table. And then, of course, pointed out that there was an African-American person around that table. So if they didn't really know about it,
How can you expect?
How can you expect? Right. But, you know, I would hazard to guess that oftentimes that African-American person is put in a position where they're not necessarily empowered to change the narrative in a way that that you would expect. Mm-hmm. And so for me, part of it has been not just the quest to have, you know, this, you know, increase in the numbers. You know, Twitter today was reporting about their new push around inclusion and how they've got these targets and they're meeting these targets and they've gone from, you know, 6% African American to 10% African American, and they're hoping to increase that. But it's like, yes, there is a numbers component to this, but at the end of the day, it's also about having folks in leadership positions so that when those conversations happen, there really can be an engagement around authenticity in that reporting.
If there are editors who understand that they want to have somebody go out and cover a story because they understand the story, that's what you need. It isn't going to be just the reporters. It has to be, as you say, the management, the editors, the presidents, vice presidents.
Right, right. Now, when this report was issued, it was about that's another thing we need to ask about. What is the correct terminology? I mean, have we settled on whether these are uprisings or riots or rebellions or?
Well, we called them riots back in the day, but they were definitely
unrest.
Unrest.
Yes. Well, anyway, back then this is reported about Negroes. They're the ones who were rioting and everything. But since then, we have become much more multicultural. How do we bring Asian Americans, Native Americans, Latinos into this conversation and into our perspectives that we're offering our readers and viewers? Any thoughts on that?
This is something that I am truly struggling with, and it's interesting because I think that the intention is there, but the action really has to follow the intention, right? So as we look to increase, for example, the representation of Latino independent producers and the content that we're bringing to the air or the stories that we're pursuing, you have to make that concerted effort. So I pick up the telephone, I have a conversation with Rainey Aronson, the executive producer of Frontline, and I say, what are you all doing about Hurricane Maria? Do you have a team who's working down in Puerto Rico? So it really is about being very clear and intentional to make sure that you're making the same overtures that as a journalist of color I would have expected for folks to make within the African American community. But it does require additional resources and quite honestly, reaching out and developing new networks that don't necessarily currently exist.
Okay, hear, hear. Did you want to add to that?
No, I think she's absolutely right. And mm-hmm. I think that the experience we had in the 2016 election, which was kind of a grab bag mm-hmm. of all these things, and it exposed glaringly these absences because there were issues of immigration, there were issues of religion, there were issues of anti-black racism, there was issues of anti-Latino racism, there was misogyny, there was issues of kind of bias and of people against people with disabilities. And I'm probably leaving some things out.
You know? Right, right.
But all of those things were emerging, yeah. And it was saying, like, these are the places that people have been saying, you know, these are real issues and these are real fault lines. And when you don't have people who can represent these stories. And the other thing is that when people claim to have been blindsided, you're blindsided because you don't have people who are in these communities saying, look, this tide is about to hit the shore.
Right.
These people who actually know these things are going on in their communities, and that disconnect allows you to go, like, you see the raving madness of Trumpism and refer to it as populism, mm-hmm. as opposed to what it actually was.
Right. What are some of the, we don't have that much time left, but what are some of the things that the media really need to be focusing in on now that we're just not seeing enough of? Mm-hmm. Any thoughts there about what kind of topics we should be looking at that we're just not, or we're just doing insufficiently? Doing a great job, huh?
No.
I think, again, I'll go back to the management. Management needs to be setting the tone mm-hmm. and making sure that there are people who are available to cover the stories that they understand.
Right, right, right. And I think a lot of it goes to what you mentioned management. What does management see as the priority?
Yeah, well.
You know, is covering communities of color actually a priority in the newsroom? Or is it sort of low on the totem pole and something that won't really advance my career all that much?
Well, that really requires a change in mindset, doesn't it?
Yes, yeah.
Because it doesn't exist now.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
I mean, you know, just picking up on your question, I mean, the last year and a half has kind of been, I don't want to say it's been funny, but it has. I mean, because literally, you have people running around trying to, like, rediscover America, you know, because, you know, the only people apparently that we cared about were people in the urban centers. And, you know, all those rural folks out there, all those folks who are just beyond the frame, we've got to go and discover them now.
Right.
But the truth is that there is a lot of truth to that. And so figuring out how to do that, but how to do that from a place of authenticity that engages those communities and finds new storytellers and doing it in that way, to me, quite honestly, I've found that the documentary community has been in the vanguard in that space, much, much more so than the daily news shops.
And coincidentally, PBS specializes in documentaries.
That would be correct.
Okay. Well, I think we're out of time now, so let's give our panelists a round of applause. Okay. And thank you very much. Okay. I think it's time for us to leave.